Okay, let us start now. This will be my last lecture on the quantum mechanics portion. Let us just discuss what we have done in the last lecture, which was early morning, today morning. We worked out a particle in a finite potential box, then we discussed some of the free state problems. One of the most important result that we obtained is that there is a certain probability for particle to get reflected, even though classically the particle could not have crossed the barrier. This is what we have said. Then we also said there is a finite probability of finding the particle in a classically forbidden region. And eventually we discussed rather briefly a tunneling phenomenon, very, very important phenomenon, which does not have a classical analog, where you can have a small separation of a classically forbidden region. And because particle have a finite probability of being found there, okay, if this is thin enough, you can have a reasonable amount of probability of the particle crossing to another area. And once the particle crosses to that area, because now that is no longer classically forbidden, the particle can keep on propagating. So this is a phenomenon which is very well known. Okay, as you know, there are a lot of semiconductor devices which are based. There are many other tunneling phenomena which are pretty well known. I mean, in fact, even these days in magnetism, tunneling magnetoresistance, there are so many things. Tunneling phenomenon has found a lot of applications, and this can be understood on the basis of quantum mechanics. So that's why I'm always surprised when people say, you know, what is the use of quantum mechanics? Because once you see off all these things, all the recent developments which have taken place in varieties of areas, you realize that how quantum mechanics has played a role in actually pushing many of these things, many of these devices, many of these applications. Okay, now we'll try to work out one or two problems. I'll take one particular specific problem, which is a sort of interesting problem, which is half the way between a particle in a finite box and infinite box. And there is only one particular aspect which I want to discuss. I want to use this particular thing to discuss a very, very specific aspect. I could have discussed this particular thing also using particle in a finite potential well, but I thought, you know, let me do one more problem and try to sort of understand it, try to discuss it. After that, you know what, I will take one or two more examples before I come to particle in a three-dimensional box. So let us look at this particular problem. So this is a particular problem which, as I say, is a sort of a mixture of particle in an infinite box and a particle in a finite box. So again, you have a box, let's say, between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. And like particle in an infinite box, for all values of x less than 0, the potential energy is infinite. While as far as x greater than L is concerned, the potential energy is V0 but is finite. Alright. So, in that sense, this is not really a symmetrical problem, unlike the problem that we have solved so far. And let us discuss the bound state solutions of this. Of course, you can always think of a free state solution when a particle comes here, but that problem is not very interesting, because if you know, if a beam of particle comes from this side, okay, it will has to, because there is a what we call is a perfect reflector here, where the potential energy is infinite, all of them have to go back, and therefore, in principle, reflection coefficient will always be equal to 1. So that problem is not of that much interest, but let us try to find out the solution of corresponding to the bound state. And for bound state, it means I am looking only for those solutions for which energy E is less than V0. Then only this particular particle is bound between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. So let us look at the bound state solution of this particular problem, where potential energy is infinite for all negative values of x is 0 between x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. And for L values of x greater than L, it is positive and it is equal to V0. Like before, I will divide into region 1 and region 2. There is no point in devising this thing as a fact of this particular region, because as we have discussed earlier, the wave function has to be 0. Of course, if you are not very satisfied why a wave function should be 0, you can always take potential, a finite potential well, and take the limit of V tending to infinite. Then you can say those, see that the only solution possible will be that wave function is 0 in this particular case. So I am dividing only in two regions, region 1 and region 2. And in this region 1, okay, the solutions will be of the sinusoidal form. While we are talking of this particular solution, this region, the solution will be exponentially decaying, because this is a classically forbidden region. So in region 1, I have written the general solution as A sin kx plus B cos kx. And because V is 0 in this particular case, k square will just turn out to be 2me upon h bar square. Again, I repeat that if you are not satisfied how I have put k square is equal to this thing, you can just substitute this equation, this particular expression back into the Schrodinger equation, and then you will get k square to be equal to this. For region 2, as I have said, this is going to be an exponential type of functions. So, I will write this particular thing as C e raised to the power alpha x plus D e raised to the power minus alpha x. And remember, alpha, when I am writing, this is V naught minus E, because this is V naught minus E, which is positive, and therefore alpha is real. In region 2, for bound state solutions, V naught minus E is going to be positive and alpha is going to be real. Now, again, I am putting my boundary conditions, which again I am jumping steps. Okay, one condition is that this solution is valid for x is equal to plus infinity. At x is equal to plus infinity, this term will blow to infinity. I do not want this term. So, I remove this particular term by putting C is equal to 0. So, the only solution which is possible, only part of this solution which is possible, is D raised to the power minus alpha x. Similarly, I will put the condition that phi 1 of at x is equal to 0 should be equal to 0. Remember, because at this particular point, there is an infinite jump in potential energy. Therefore, I do not have to match d phi dx. I have to match only phi 1. And for values of x less than 0, here the wave function is 0. So, wave function must be 0 at x is equal to 0. So, you put x is equal to 0, then you get sin 0 and you will get b cos 0 is 1. So, a sin 0 is 0. So, you will get just b. It means b should be equal to 0. So, you will get b is equal to 0 and c is equal to 0. So, remember, if the solution has to start from here at x is equal to 0, it is only a sine term which can be present. Okay, this is just from pure thinking. Okay, because cos term at x is equal to 0 will not be equal to 0. So, cos term will not be allowed, because at x is equal to 0, you expect only the sine term will be 0. Therefore, you will always have this particular b coefficient b to be equal to 0. Okay, now you put the boundary condition at x is equal to L, which is the wave function should match. And remember, at x is equal to L, the potential jump is finite. So, I have to match derivatives also. At x is equal to 0, I did not match, because at x is equal to 0, the potential jump was infinite. Here, the potential jump is only finite. Here, the potential jump is only finite. So, at this particular edge, I have to match not only the wave function, but also the derivative of the wave function. So, just like before, remember, this was my sin kx. So, I put x is equal to L. So, you get a sin kl. This term was 0. So, you will get d e raised to the power minus alpha L. So, this is what I have written. Then you take the derivative of that and put x is equal to L. So, this, remember, this dash which I have written means derivative with respect to x. You get this particular condition. So, you must have a sin kl is equal to d e raised to the power minus alpha L and a k cos kl is equal to minus alpha dl. I just divide the two. D gets cancelled and the solution turns out to be cot kl is equal to minus alpha by k. Like what I have discussed earlier, in a particular finite box, okay, alpha and k both are dependent on energy. This is alpha and this is k, both are dependent on energy. Therefore, solving this equation cot kl is equal to minus alpha by k, you will be able to get the values of energy. Only for certain values, specific values of energy, will this equation be satisfied, and those will be the only values of energy which will be allowed for this particular particle. As you can see, that in this particular case, you find that the equation which is governing the energy is comparatively simpler in comparison to the particle in a finite box. Now, the next question which I wanted to talk about it, that if I have to solve a general solution for this particular equation and find energy in the closed equation in the form of an equation, as I have said, it is not very easy. This cannot be done in principle. And definitely for a particle in a finite dimensional box, one dimensional box, it becomes much more difficult. Okay. But on the other hand, if I want to solve the question at what should be the value of V naught, or for that matter, what should be the value of length of this particular box, for which one of the allowed energy is a unique value, a particular value. Okay. That can be done comparatively easily. So, this is what I have tried and tried to answer this particular question. I want to find out that, okay, what should be the value of V naught or L, corresponding to which I will get one particular energy just at E is equal to 0. So, what I am looking, that this is, sorry, at E is equal to V naught, not E is equal to 0, because this is what. So, I want one particular energy level, which is what I call is just bound. See, remember, if energy was greater than V naught, this will become a free state. If energy is less than V naught, then this becomes a bound state. Now, I want to find out a condition that what should be the value of, for a given L, what should be the value of V, or for a given V, what should be the value of L, corresponding to which I will get just a state which is just bound. This particular thing has a specific meaning, as we'll be discussing a little later. Okay, let me also tell you, if I have given you the problem, what will be the value for a given value of L, what will be the condition on V naught, so that the value of energy value of the bound state is just equal to V naught by 2. That also I can do, that's much simpler. Okay, but to find out, given an arbitrary value of V naught and given an arbitrary value of L, what will be the value of energy of the bound state, that is a little more difficult question. Now I am saying that I want to look specifically at solution corresponding to E is equal to V naught. Let me just go back to this equation. I want a solution corresponding to which I will get a state which is just bound. Okay, it means it's just V is equal to V naught. Okay, let's try to find out the condition for that particular case. If I do that, then remember, because I am looking specifically for solution V naught is equal to E, so under root 2m V naught minus E, will this particular term will become 0, therefore alpha will become equal to 0. And because E is equal to V naught, so therefore K will be under root 2m V naught by h cross. Now I can relook at what will be my boundary conditions. My boundary condition will just become A sin KL is equal to D. Remember, this was my A sin KL is equal to D raised power minus alpha L, because alpha has become equal to 0. So this condition becomes A sin KL is equal to D. Similarly, if I look at this condition, it is AK cos KL is equal to 0, which is also obvious from this particular thing, because this alpha is 0. So this entire term is going to be 0. If this entire term is going to be 0, this is going to be AK cos KL should be equal to 0. Of course, you could have obtained also by substituting it here, but I thought of doing it right from basics. So if at all we have a bound state just at E is equal to V naught, in that case, this condition must be satisfied. See, for example, if AK cos KL is equal to 0, then we said A cannot be 0, because if AZ is 0, the wave function itself can become 0. So only cos KL equal to 0 would be allowed. So what happens here, that A cannot be 0, so only cos KL can be equal to 0. If cos KL is equal to 0, then it means KL must be equal to 2n plus 1 pi by 2. Only when KL takes one of these values where n is an integer, it is possible for cos KL to become 0. It means if potential energy, I have just substituted the value, of course we know KL, which I have already substituted under root 2m V naught minus h cross. It means for a given value of L, if I have this potential energy, only then I will have a bound state just at E is equal to V naught. As you can see, there are multiple values of V naught for which this condition will be satisfied. So if n is equal to, let's say, 0, then in that case, this particular value of V naught will correspond to h square pi square by 2 square upon 2 ml square. Okay, there will be one particular bound state at E is equal to V naught. Okay, then if I put n is equal to 1, then I will get another value of V naught corresponding to which there will be another bound state. Now let us just sort of try to interpret this particular thing a little more clearly. In fact, this particular aspect is a little difficult aspect, which in fact I found the students also find it a little difficult to understand. So let's just go a little slowly about this particular thing. Now, first statement which I make, that there will be no bound state if V naught is less than equal to h square pi square by 8 ml square. How did I obtain this particular expression? I put n is equal to 0. If I put n is equal to 0, you get pi square by 4 square. Okay, let me first write, then I will display. So just you see, because n was turning out to be equal to 0, so this is h square pi square by 4, this divided by 2 ml square. So this becomes h square pi square by 8 ml square. Now what I am trying to say is that this is the least value of V naught which is required for which you will get a bound state corresponding to this energy. What happens if V naught was smaller than this? Okay, because V naught is something, depending upon problem, I'm just looking at a theoretical ways. Let's suppose there is a way by which I can continually vary V naught. If I keep on reducing V naught, and let us suppose there is a problem where V naught is less than this particular value, okay, what I insist that this particular problem will not have any bound state. There is no energy allowed, state allowed, in which the particle will be bound. Only free states will be allowed. The reason for that is a little subtle, so let us try to understand it. Let us suppose initially we have a condition when this particular well was not existing at all. Okay, so you have this particular thing, and I reduce this so much that the well is only like this, almost like this. Okay, then I slowly increase like this. Now, what I want to say that the least value of V naught for which you have a bound state here, now if I keep on continually decreasing, I will not find a bound state coming here until my V naught is dug to this particular value, which is equal to h square pi square by 8 ml square. For all values of V naught smaller than, there is no bound state. Now, it is not possible for you to suddenly create a bound state. If I am reducing here, then in that particular case, whenever a new bound state comes, that will always start appearing from E is equal to V naught. That is one particular thing which I want to insist on this particular thing. Let us see whether people understand this particular issue or not very correctly. Because all our variables are well behaved variables, okay, and I require a certain minimum value of V naught to create a bound state here. Let us suppose if we had just a situation like this. This was x is equal to 0 and x is equal to L. It means essentially this particular potential well was not existent at all. In that case, you agree that there cannot be any bound state. Now I start digging my bound states, I am digging my well, and this is becoming slightly less. But I know I have just dug it slightly. But I know that my bound state cannot appear here at x is equal to 0, because this is just very, very close. If at all a bound state has to come, I am starting from a continuum state, and as I am slowly digging my well, okay, a bound state has to start appearing, and a bound state cannot suddenly start coming half the way. It has to start always from this particular case. This is something which is very, very important. A bound state, a new bound state will always start appearing from the boundary of a free state and a bound state. That is what I am trying to essentially assess on this particular thing. If it was very, very close to this, bound state I know does not exist because it is very, very close to E is equal to V naught, okay. And for a bound state to appear at E is equal to V naught, I must at least have this much V naught. So, if I have any value of this, if I slowly keep on going from this condition to this condition, whenever a bound state comes, it will first start from here, then start going down. So, initially a bound state will be here, then as I dig more, this particular bound state will go down and keep on going down. Then unless I get another value of V naught corresponding to which a energy E is equal to V naught is allowed, then a second bound state will start coming in. Thing that I am trying to insist is that whenever a new bound state starts coming in, okay, that will always, let me put it like that, if I continuously vary V naught, okay, start from a situation, if I go from a situation where this is essentially V naught is equal to 0, so this point is here, and continuously making V naught little larger, then whenever the first bound state will come, it will always appear from this particular point. Then as I dig it more, this particular bound state will start coming down and down and down. Then I, of course, given a particular arbitrary value of V naught and L, I will not be able to find out for an arbitrary value where is this particular bound state. But one thing is definite, whenever, if I have dug it enough so that a new bound state starts coming in, that will first appear at this particular point and then only it will start going down. So, in principle, by looking at the value of V naught and L, I can find out how many number of bound states will be there in such type of situation. You cannot have infinite bound states, unlike particle in infinite box where you can have infinite bound state. Here you will have, depending upon value of V naught and L, you will have only a finite number of bound states. So, what I am insisting is that there will be no bound state if V naught is less than h square pi square by 8 ml square, because this is the least value of V naught which is required to create a bound state at E is equal to V naught. Now, we will have only one bound state unless a second bound state starts appearing at E is equal to V naught. Second bound states will start appearing at E is equal to V naught when n becomes equal to 1. When n becomes equal to 1, so n is 1, so 2 plus 1, so this will become 9 square, okay, and 9 upon 8 ml square. So, until this reaches a value of 9 h square pi square by 8 ml square. Once your V naught becomes equal to this, then again I will get a bound state exactly at E is equal to V naught. Okay? So, between this value and this value, I will get only one particular bound state. As I keep on increasing V naught further, then this second bound state which was created, which will now keep on going to lower value, it will no longer be at that particular boundary, it will keep on going down, okay, until I hit a particular value of V naught which corresponds to n is equal to 2. When it hits to n is equal to 2, a third bound state will start appearing at E is equal to V naught, and then at that particular instant of time, you have 3 bound states. So depending upon what is the value of V naught, you can actually check, you can actually find out without solving that equation how many number of bound states will appear in this particular problem. So this is what is very, very interesting about this particular thing, that you can actually create, you can always find out the total number of the bound states in this particular case. So between this and this, you will have just one bound state. Then I can always find out what will be the condition when you have just two bound states. Then we can find out the condition when we'll have just three bound state. Of course, this question can also be answered in terms of L. I could have fixed my V naught and said that what will be the values of L corresponding to which I will get a particular bound state. Because see, what appears in these equations is basically V naught multiplied by L square. In fact, morning I had to say V naught square into L. That's not correct. V naught into L square. Now let's have some comments on this. First of all, is that a finite V naught is needed for a bound state to exist. In this particular problem, you definitely require a finite value of V naught for a bound state to create. If V naught is less than that, you will not get a bound state. This problem has an alternate allowed energies for a particle in one dimensional box of length 2L with the same potential. Okay, this is also an interesting point. This is actually invoking symmetry. If you have a situation like this, a problem which I solved in the morning, actually if you look at the first bound state, the wave function would look something like that, because this is a sinusoidal term. So it will be something like this. And this will exponentially decay here, exponentially decay here. This will be the ground state solution. The first excited solution for this particular thing, see, actually there is a theorem in quantum mechanics which says that in Cartesian coordinate system, when you are going to the next excited state, the first excited state or the ground state will have no crossing with x-axis. When you are going to the first excited state, you will have just one crossing. Okay, let me not bother about this particular thing. Let's just go to the second bound state. So as the ground state, if I look at the second excited state, okay, it will become like this, because this has to have one crossing, and because of symmetry, this curve must be symmetric about this particular point. Okay, and this will decay like this, and this will decay exponentially like this. This has to be symmetrical about this particular point. Now, what you will notice that if I divide this particular thing half, okay, this will not satisfy. See, my problem which I am solving, trying to solve now, is that there is a perfect reflector at this particular point. Now, what is very interesting to realize that this particular solution will just satisfy this particular condition also when there is a perfect boundary, provided we take only this half of the wave function, ignore this particular half of the wave function. So, what will happen, whatever energy that I would have got corresponding to this value of V naught and a length 2L, okay, this will obviously will not be allowed solution, because this actually I at x is equal to L, I mean in the present problem, let me put it like 0, let me put plus L and minus L, 0 plus L and minus L. The problem that we had here was 0 and L. Alright, now here in this particular problem, I wanted that the wave function should be 0 at x is equal to 0. This wave function will not be 0 at x is equal to 0, but this wave function is 0 at x is equal to 0. Now, this particular thing will have a wavelength exactly of whatever is this particular wavelength, and it satisfies this boundary condition as well as this particular boundary condition. So, if I just cut this particular thing into half, this will turn out to be a solution of this. Now, if I look at the third one, it will have two boundaries, two crossings, and then the wave function will be looking something like this. And in that case, again at x is equal to 0, you will not find that the condition of wave function being 0 gets satisfied. Okay? Only when I go to the fourth one, then again, because we will have two things, again at x is equal to 0, you will find the wave function to be 0. So, what you will find, whatever are the solutions corresponding to this you have obtained, if you ignore the first one, take the second one, ignore third one, take the fourth one, then alternate of these solutions will turn out to be solution of this particular problem. So, this is very, very interesting, which can be argued purely from the symmetry point of view without doing, in fact, symmetries in quantum mechanics are sometimes very, very interesting. So, this problem has alternate allowed energies of a particle in one dimensional box of length 2L with the same potential, purely from symmetrical arguments. Okay? In this particular case, I want to insist that you will always have a bound state irrespective of the value of V naught. So, if I go back to this particular picture, see, remember, in this particular case, this particular state is also there, which is not present here. Now, you can show, I mean, this I leave this as an exercise for you to show, that even if you reduce this particular thing to almost zero thing, you will always get a bound state here. this particular state will always be present. But in this case, because this is not the allowed one, this state will require certain type of potential. So in a finite potential well of like this, you will always get one bound state, irrespective of howsoever small is your V naught. But in this case, you will get only a bound state when V naught acquires a certain value depending upon the value of V naught and L. So this is what is very, very interesting. A bound state always exists in a letter case, which is the case of one dimensional box of length 2L, finite well. Okay, obviously it should be finite. Now let me try to work out a little more realistic problem, which is a very, very well known problem, which is called the problem of harmonic oscillator. So let us assume that there is a particular particle which is experiencing a force of the type of Hooke's law, which is minus kx, and you know corresponding to that force the potential energy is given by half kx square. So if I have to write a Schrodinger equation for an harmonic oscillator, a particle which is under the influence of force which is called F is equal to minus kx, Hooke's law type of force, then this is the equation, Schrodinger equation, that one has to solve. And let us assume that this is a one dimensional harmonic oscillator. Now if I want to start from basics and I want to really solve this particular equation in its most general fashion, this is going to be much more difficult and definitely is beyond the scope of this particular course. Okay, one has to look at the book of a proper quantum mechanics book, the first level book, and let us say like Schiff or any standard book, there are so many books which deal with this, then they will give you a general solution. What I am trying to do is to do the other way. I am giving you a solution which I know somehow. Okay. So this solution, suppose I know, I want to show that this particular solution is going to be of the form which I have described here, phi x is equal to a e raised to power minus alpha x square. And using this particular solution, I can tell what will be the energy corresponding to this particular solution. So I am doing this in a much more simple fashion. Let us say somehow I have hit upon a value of phi x. Let me just repeat, this is not the way that you would like to solve harmonic oscillator problem. You will actually start with this equation and try to work it out, this particular thing, in a most general fashion. Okay, the solutions are much more complex, which are called Hermite polynomials, okay, which, as I say, is beyond the scope of this course. But I want to just show it, basically I want to demonstrate to first year students that this is a really a realistic problem of harmonic oscillator, okay, and we know what are the energy levels for this particular thing. Okay, so let us look at this particular equation. I am telling you that somehow I know this particular solution. I want to only convince that this is actually a solution and then find out using this solution what will be the value of energy for which this will be the solution. In fact, this is the solution corresponding to the ground state of harmonic oscillator, which is corresponding to the lowest energy state. Okay. Now what I will do, because I want to show that this is a solution, so I will substitute this particular solution into this particular equation. So let us go to the next one. This is phi x. So in order to substitute, first I have to find out the, I have to differentiate with respect to x. If I differentiate, okay, this is exponential function, so it will be present as it is, e raised to power minus alpha x square multiplied by differential of minus alpha x square. Okay, alpha is a constant, so it will be minus 2 alpha x. So this is the differential coefficient of phi with respect to x. Now I take the second derivative, second order differential coefficient. So I have to, now this is a product of two functions of x. Okay, so I have to differentiate this multiplied by this plus differential of this multiplied by this. So this is the first thing which I have taken. I have taken minus 2 alpha x into differential coefficient of this. When I take differential coefficient of this, I will get again this particular term. Okay, so this is what is there, and there is already minus 2 alpha x, so now it becomes minus 2 alpha x square. Then I take this as a constant and differentiate this particular thing, so I will get only minus 2 alpha. So this is what it is. So this is d2 phi dx square. I substitute this into Schrodinger equation. This is the term which I have written. This is what I have just now found out, d2 phi dx square plus 2m upon h square, e minus v, v is half kx square, and phi I know, which I have started with the solution a e raised power minus alpha x square. Alright, then I sort of start reorganizing the term. So there is minus, in fact, a e raised power minus alpha x square would cancel everywhere. The wave function cannot be 0, so I can always cancel it out. So I will get minus 2 alpha x square here. Then I will get minus 2 alpha, which is the second term here, and this third term will remain as plus 2m upon h square e raised to power half kx square, because this term goes away. Now what I will do here, I will try to reorganize this term. If I expand this particular thing, I will get x square, there will be x square. There are certain terms which are constant. For example, this term does not contain alpha, this term will not contain x. Similarly, this term will also not contain x. So there will be four terms, 1, 2, 3, 4, two of which will contain x square, and two of which will be constant. So, all I am trying to do is to reorganize these terms. So, I am just reorganizing these terms, okay, x square, this is the same equation which I have written earlier. Now, first I assemble all the terms which are x square. So, there will be x square term which is here, which is I take the square of this thing. So, I get 4 alpha square. So, this is 4 alpha square. There is another x square term which is this half will cancel it out. So, mk upon h square. So, you get mk upon h square. Both these terms contain x square. There are two constant terms. One is minus 2 alpha, which is here minus 2 alpha. There is another constant term plus 2m upon h square. So, you get an equation of the type ax square plus b is equal to 0. So, you have an equation of this type. Now, this you can say is a quadratic equation. So, can I find out the value of fx, okay, for which this equation is satisfied? No, I do not want to do this. I want that this particular equation should be a general solution. It means for all values of x, this should be correct. Okay? I do not want a solution which has to be valid only for a specific value of x. See, this particular solution which I have obtained or which should be there from solution of Schrodinger equation should be valid for all values of x. So, this particular equation must get satisfied for all values of x, not for some specific values of x. And that is only possible when this a is also equal to 0 and b is also equal to 0. Only when these two terms are 0, then this particular equation will always be satisfied irrespective of the value of x. So, for all values of x, this equation has to be satisfied only when this coefficient of x square and this constant terms both become individually 0. So, that is what I have shown last time in the next transparency. So, this is there. So, I will put this term to be 0 and I will put this term to be 0. This is the equation. First thing, I have put this equal to 0. So, I get a value of alpha which turn out to be under root mk upon 2h cross. Second, I put this particular term to be equal to 0. So, in fact, from this I have found out the value of alpha in terms of the force constant and the mass of the oscillator. 2m upon h square, this gives me energy in terms of alpha h square by m. I substitute this particular value of alpha and I can find out what will be the energy of this particular particle. This turns out to be, I just substitute it here, and this energy will turn out to be equal to half h cross under root k by m, and as generally under root k by m is written as omega, okay, this is half h cross omega. So, I can see that this is the value of energy which will get corresponding to this wave function. So, in fact, if you know about the harmonic oscillator energy levels, harmonic oscillator energy levels are given by En is equal to n plus half h cross omega or h nu. Remember, Planck originally took En is equal to n h cross omega. Remember, this was a hypothesis. He did not have Schrodinger equation to derive these things. Okay, but when we take Schrodinger equation, we get exactly this form, except for this additional term of half, which I said that the ground state energy, the lowest energy cannot be 0. Here for n is equal to 0, the energy will be equal to 0. Here what you actually get, that there is a what we call as a 0 point energy, energy corresponding to the lowest energy state, this being a bound state. Remember, this is an exponential solution, okay, but still treated as a bound solution because the particle's physical extent is still limited to a definite region of the space. So, for a bound state problem, the energy, lowest energy has to be a non-zero, and this turns out to be equal to half h cross omega. What I would suggest that you can try another type of form, which is the first excited state, which the solution will be of the form x into e raise power minus alpha x square, and there you will find out that this particular thing, you know, the second energy that you will be getting 3 by 2 h cross omega exactly in the same fashion. So, it will just, if you put, if I would have given you this particular thing not as a into this, but a x into e raise power minus alpha x square, try this solution yourself, try to work out exactly in the same fashion. It requires exactly the same steps, except that, you know, second derivative will have a slightly more number of terms, and you will get that now this equation will get satisfied with an energy 3 by 2 h cross omega. So, you can actually see that this is the way the energy spectrum will be looking like that. I would also just like to mention something in support of the 0 point energy. I am not sure whether you are familiar with this particular thing, that helium gas, which is the lightest inert gas, okay. See, because the inert gas, the bonding forces are very, very small. They are only the van der Waal forces, which are very, very weak forces. In fact, that is why it is rather difficult to liquefy the inert gases. And for helium, it's believed that you cannot solidify even if you go to 0 degree Kelvin. Of course, people do not go to 0 degree Kelvin, you cannot reach 0 degree Kelvin. But looking at this particular helium, they say that because of the ground's zero point energy, it's impossible to solidify helium at even if you go to very, very low temperatures. Only when you put pressure on liquid helium that you can get a solid helium. Okay, this is actually treated as an evidence of actually possession of zero point energy. Now I come to the last problem of my lecture, which is a particle in a three-dimensional cubical box. This particular problem is probably the one of the most interesting problems from the point of view of solid state physics, and when Professor Suresh teaches solid state physics, he would be using this particular result. See, as we have said that one-dimensional boxes are generally only from the point of view of theoretical interest. Okay, of course, there are always certain cases from which you can draw the parallel of the one-dimensional box, but three-dimensional cubical box is a more interesting problem. Okay, you can always imagine a particular particle to be sort of contained within a particular box of three dimension, okay, in a room, or of course the room is too big, but I mean you can imagine room at a microscopic level when there is a particular electron which is confined to a three dimensional box. There are certain specific things I want to introduce from here, the concept of degeneracy, okay, which we have not yet introduced, okay. Then essentially this particular aspect of the quantum mechanics course, you know, we'll close it down. So now, just like we had one dimensional box, we have three dimensional box. We find that the potential energy is zero only within this box. It means only when x is less than zero, x is between zero and L, and similarly y is also between zero and L, and also similarly z is also between zero and L. Okay, in all other cases the potential energy is infinite. So potential is zero only when this particular my x, y, z values lies somewhere within this cubical box. For easiness, I have taken this to be cubical. Even if it is rectangular, I mean not really cubical, you could have worked it out, but it's more interesting from the point of view of cubical, or rather more simple from the point of view of cubical box. Now what I have to do, because this is a three-dimensional problem, I have to solve a three-dimensional Schrodinger equation, and this equation I have given you, the general equation has been given to you earlier. So this becomes my three-dimensional Schrodinger equation which I have given earlier. If you look at my earlier notes, this is what we have written. And then this del square operator in three dimension is written as del 2 psi del x square, del 2 psi del y square, del 2 psi del z square. Remember, generally because it's a three dimensional space, so wave function would consist of all these three coordinates x, y and z. And therefore, when I am taking partial derivative with respect to x, it means y and z have to be treated as constant. If I am taking partial derivative with respect to y, x and z have to be treated constant, and so on. Okay, because potential energy is zero within the box, so I have put v is equal to zero. So the equation just becomes 2m upon h square e times phi is equal to zero. Now we use this particular method, separation of variable, to solve this equation. So remember, we have used this particular method of separation of variable when I obtained time independent Schrodinger equation from time dependent Schrodinger equation. From time dependent Schrodinger equation, I separated the time variable and the x variable, and then we got two differential equations. Okay, one containing time term, and that particular time term dependent term we had, because that did not contain potential energy, so we solved it separately. Then whatever was remaining was time independent Schrodinger equation. Now we use the same procedure of separation of variables. In fact, once you go to the problem of hydrogen atom, that's what you exactly do, except that in that particular problem you have a spherical symmetry, so you express this del square using r theta phi coordinates. You do not use x, y, z coordinates, but here we use x, y and z coordinates. There also we separate out variable, and here also we separate out the variables. Okay, so what I will do, I will assume that this phi is product of three functions. So this is an assumption. Okay, if using this assumption I am able to solve, separate out the variables, I am successful, it's fine. If not, it means this particular method of solving the Schrodinger equation would not work. My logics are exactly identical. I have to take derivative first, partial derivative with respect to x. Okay, and I am assuming that this x is only a function of x coordinate, this capital Y is only a function of y coordinate, this capital Z is only a function of small z coordinate. Alright. So if I take partial derivative with respect to x, capital Y and capital Z will be treated as constant. Even if I take the second derivative, still capital Y and capital Z will be treated as constant. So it will become capital Y capital Z into del 2x del x square. But as we have said that this particular term contains only x, Okay, so there is no point in writing partial derivatives because this has only x, no other variable. So I just write this as d2x dx square. So this equation, this particular first term becomes yz d2x dz square. Remember, this is my equation. This is what I have found out. Similarly, I will now find out d2 phi dy square. In that case, x and z will be treated as constant and only capital Y will be differentiated with respect to y. Here, capital X and capital Y will be treated as constant and only capital Z will be differentiated with respect to small z. This is what has happened, capital Y, capital Z, d2x dx square, capital X, capital Z, d2y dy square and capital X, capital Y, d2z dz square, plus of course in this equation place of phi I have written capital X, capital Y, capital Z as before. So this is what has been written here. Alright, now what I will do, exactly the same thing, I will divide by xyz. When I divide this by xyz, I will get here 1 upon x d2x dx square. Okay, remember xyz cannot be 0, so I can always divide it. Okay, then when I divide this by capital X, capital Y, capital Z, I will get 1 upon capital Y. Similarly, I will get capital Z and this particular term will become 2m upon h square, 2me upon h square. This will become 1, xyz divided by xyz. So this particular thing I can take on the right hand side and I will use exactly the same argument. I will have three terms which is equal to a constant. First term contains only x, second term contains only y, third term contains only z, okay, and this must always be equal to a constant irrespective of x, y and z, and that is possible when all the three terms individually are constants. This is what I have written. This was the first term which I had written earlier. I had divided by capital X, capital Y, capital Z. So this becomes 1 upon X, d2X, dx square, dx square, 1 upon capital Y, d2Y, dy square, 1 upon Z, capital d2Z, dz square. This I have divided, so it becomes just 2ME upon H square, which I have taken on the right hand side. Okay. So therefore, you just find it out that these three terms turn out to be equal to a constant. This is purely a function of X, this is purely a function of Y, this is purely a function of Z. Okay, if this equation has to be satisfied, all three of them have to be individually constant. Because for example, if I just change x, okay, and if this is not a constant, this term will change, but this term will not change. Okay, so the result cannot remain constant. If I just change y and do not change x and z, okay, if this is not a constant, this term will change, but these two terms will not change. So their sum can never remain constant. So if their sum has to remain constant, only possibility is that all these three terms individually remain constant. So this is very, very interesting because here in one shot you can separate out the variables. Generally when we separate out r theta phi coordinates in hydrogen atom case, we actually separate them out one by one. Okay. In this case, in one shot you are able to separate out the three variables and you get three differential equations out of this particular one differential equation. So this is what I have written, and for the convenience I have written as minus kx square minus ky square minus kz square. The reason is that if you look at this particular equation, the sum of this equation has to be equal to minus 2me upon h square, because I am looking for a solution which are for which e is positive, because potential energy is already 0, so e is always has to be positive. Therefore, their sum has to be positive. Therefore, I am writing this in the form of minus kx square minus ky square minus kz square, such that kx square plus ky square plus kz square must be equal to 2me upon h square. So this just ensures that writing this x square ensures that this particular quantity is positive, this particular quantity is positive, this particular quantity is positive, and the negative sign is taken here and taken here. Alright. So this is the equation which must be satisfied. The only thing is now that we have now three different equations and we can solve all these three equations individually. This equation happens to be exactly the same way which we have solved for a particle in a one-dimensional infinite box. So I will put exactly the same solution, which will be of a sin kx plus b cos kx. Only thing, here there are three different kx's. Here is one kx, another is ky, another kz. So all these three equations have to be written in terms of different kx's. So this, let's first solve only for x. If I solve for x, I just write this capital X and this constant, just for convenience, I have defined as Ax. This constant I have defined as Bx. So solution will be A sin kx. This I have written because here there was a minus kx square. Okay, these are, see, in principle these three can vary, such that the only condition is that their sum should be equal to this 2me upon h square. Alright. Now I have to put boundary conditions. I put boundary conditions exactly the same way. What I want, that once along the x direction I go outside the box, it means my L value of x becomes less than 0, or value of x becomes greater than L, I know the wave function has to be 0. The boundary is at x is equal to 0 and at x is equal to L. So at that particular point, my wave function must be 0, exactly the same way that we have been doing it earlier. Okay, it means wave function at x is equal to 0, irrespective of y and z value, must be equal to 0. Wave function at x is equal to L, irrespective of y and z value, must be equal to 0. Okay, so I just put these conditions and I will get exactly the same way as I had got for a particle in a one-dimensional box. So capital X is equal to 0, capital X, this is only possible because this is the only term which depends on X. No other terms depends on X out of the wave function. So if this has to be 0, I had to put here capital X is equal to 0, then only I'll be able to solve it. I cannot put in Y or Z because that does not contain X. So this condition implies that at X is equal to 0, small x is equal to 0, capital X should be equal to 0. Similarly, at small x is equal to capital L, capital X should be equal to 0. Like this, before we get, there cannot be a cosine term present. So we'll have Bx is equal to 0 and KXL should be equal to Nx pi. So up till this point, it is exactly identical for particle in a box, except for the fact that in a particle in a one-dimensional box, whatever we are getting as Ka was directly related to energy, but here energy depends not only on Kx, also depends on Ky and also depends on Kz. Now, using exactly similar arguments, I can solve for Y component and Z components also, and we will get exactly same conditions. I will get KyL is equal to Ny pi, okay, and capital Y I will get as Ay sin KyY. Similarly, we will get KzL is equal to Nz pi, okay, and therefore capital Z will be Az sin Kz pi. Alright, and now the energy will be given by three terms. There will be Nx, Ny and Nz, because Kx square plus Ky square plus Kz square must be equal to 2me upon h square. Therefore, I find out what will be the value of h. H will be, has to be equal to h square upon 2m Kx square plus Ky square plus Kz square, and I have said Kx must be equal to an integer multiplied by pi divided by L. Similarly, Ny has to be another integer, okay, which is Ny pi by L. So looking at that particular thing, I get this as h square pi square 2ml square Nx square plus Ny square plus Nz square. So only those values of energy corresponding to which Nx, Ny and Nz are positive integers, okay, will be the one which will solve the correct boundary conditions and therefore will represent the energy of the particle. See, one another interesting thing here is that these Nx, Ny, Nz are independent. Okay, Nx, Ny, Nz can take independently whatever value they want, except the only thing is that they must be integer, they must be positive integers. For example, this Nx could be 1, this Ny could be 10 and Nz could be 25. Okay, that's still an allowed energy. There is no restriction on Nx, Ny, Nz, or there is no relationship. Okay, what you will find in the case of hydrogen, when you talk about hydrogen atom, you get three quantum numbers there also, okay, which are called N, M and ML, okay, but their values turn out to be interdependent. Okay, depending upon one particular value of N, you can have only certain selected values of ML. So they cannot vary independently. Okay, while in this particular case of particle in a three-dimensional box, these all three Nx, Ny and Nz can vary independently. My wave function now becomes this. Okay. Now, because there was an Ax, there was another Ay here, there is another Az. So, I have combined all those things and put this as A. So, my wave function is A sin, of course, it depends on what is the value of Nx. In fact, these Nx, Ny, Nz values are generally called quantum numbers. So, there are three quantum numbers in this particular problem, and depending upon these quantum numbers, the wave function would be different. And of course, by nature of the equation, A is always a constant which has to be determined from normalization. Of course, you have to take a three-dimensional normalization, normalize within the box and put the probability of finding the particle anywhere in the box to be equal to 1, and then only you will be able to determine A, which I will not determine because this is rather simple. If you are interested, you can do it, and it is given in almost every textbook. Okay. Now, my issue was to introduce the concept of degeneracy, which I will do just now. So, these are the comments. They are three interdependent quantum numbers which determine energy. So, there are three independent quantum numbers Nx, Ny and Nz. Okay. And then they are independent, so not interdependent, independent quantum numbers. Okay. They can all vary independently. And the corresponding the quantum number which gives you the least energy, which is we call as the ground state energy, corresponds to Nx is equal to 1, Ny is equal to 1, Nz is equal to 1. We have mentioned earlier also in a particle in a one-dimensional box that if nx becomes, if any one of them becomes 0, then in that case this wave function will become 0. If this is 0, then this is sine 0 and the entire wave function becomes 0. If the wave function becomes 0, it means the probability of finding particle inside the box becomes 0. Okay, but we have been told that there is a particle inside a box. Okay, so this is definitely not an acceptable solution. Okay, phi must remain non-zero, and therefore the least value of the three quantum numbers allowed is nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 1, and nz is equal to 1. Okay, this is the least one which is allowed as a ground state energy. Now, this is what I was calling as a degeneracy. There are different set of quantum numbers which give exactly the same energy, even though they have different wave function. Let's look at nx is equal to 2, ny is equal to 1, nz is equal to 1. So, I have written as 2, 1, 1, or nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 2, and nz is equal to 1, and nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 1, and nz is equal to 2. Let's go back to this particular equation, my earlier equation. This is my energy. So, if this becomes 2, this becomes 1 and 1, this term becomes 4 plus 1 plus 1, 6. Okay? If this is 1, this becomes 2 and this becomes 1, then I again get 1 plus 4 plus 1, again I get 6. If this becomes 1, this becomes 1, this becomes 2, again I get 6. All these possibilities, nx is equal to 2, ny is equal to 1, 1, so 2, 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, or 1, 1, 2. All three of them will give me exactly the same value of energy, but the wave functions accorded for us, they will be different. So, here if nx is equal to 2, this particular thing along the x direction will show 2 loops, while along the y direction it will show only 1 loop, while this also along the z axis will show only 1 loop, only 1 wiggle, no, 1 half of the wavelength. Okay? While if I take ny is equal to 2, along the x direction it will show only half wavelength, along the y axis it will show full wavelength, and z axis it will show half wavelength. Okay? So, these wave functions are going to be different. Okay? So, these are called degenerate states, but all these are allowed states of the particle. Alright? Now, if we come to, let us say, a electron which obeys Pauli exclusion principle to occupy, because these happen to be three different states. So, all these three states individually can be occupied by two electrons, one with spin up, another with spin down. Alright? So, if we take spin degeneracy also into consideration, of course, spin does not come specifically from the solution of Schrodinger equation. Okay, but we know that spin exists and it has its own degeneracy. So, you will find that all these three states which have the same energy in principle will occupy two, let us say fermions or two particles, let us say talk of electrons because there is a spin half. Okay, so, there are two double degeneracy. So, these three states can accommodate six electrons, even though the energy of all of them will be identical. So, these are what called, which are called degenerate states, the states which have sort of different type of wave functions, okay, but on the other hand they represent the same energy. Also, there is some interest in degeneracy because by application of some external perturbation like electric field, magnetic field, it may be possible many times to remove the degeneracy. I think Professor Suresh, when he was talking about magnetism, might have talked, I am not very sure, about the removal of degeneracy. It is generally possible sometimes that by applying external influence, some of the states which are degenerate, their degeneracy can be removed. It means you can make a slight, there is the energies of these states become, may become slightly different. Degeneracy is a very, very important aspect in quantum mechanics and especially in solid state physics, because when we are talking of a very large number of electrons occupying, let us say, states in metal, okay, then we do consider these type of things that, you know, how many states are, how many electrons are possible to be occupied in a state with a given energy. Okay, and that becomes very, very important to consider degeneracy. So, let me come back here. The first excited state is what we call as a triply degenerate because there are three wave functions which give rise to the same equation. Okay, this triply degenerate excluding spin. I mean, one has to be very, very clear, one cannot doubt. This is a triply degenerate excluding spin. They are clear cut three different type of wave functions which give you exactly the same energy. These wave functions are different from each other, but their energies corresponding to them is same, calling them degenerate state. Now, I will essentially end this particular lecture and the quantum mechanics portion. Other than just giving one particular argument, because this is a question which a very large number of students ask, and you know, I thought, I always think of specifying. See, in earlier equation, I have written kx square plus ky square plus kz square should be equal to a positive quantity here. All right. Now, people many times ask, is it not possible that one of these ky square can be negative? It means ky square can be negative. It means one ky can be imaginary. such that overall sum is positive, because all I want that the energy should be positive. Now, in principle, it should be possible that you have kx square minus ky square plus kz square and have the same energy. So, what I want to show is that a value corresponding to negative energy is not possible to be satisfied by boundary condition. So, this is my last two transparencies, and then we'll just close this particular chapter. So, can kx be imaginary? Is there a possibility that one of the ki squares is negative and others are positive, such that their sum is positive? One can always think mathematically. Okay, so let's assume that is kx square, which is negative. It means kx is imaginary. In that case, the solution of x would be slightly different, and the solution will be of the form ax e raised to power alpha x plus bx into e raised to power minus alpha x, because I have said kx is imaginary, so therefore alpha will be real. So, then the solution I will not write as a sine and cosine term, but I will write like this. Okay, but all I want to show that this type of solution is not possible, because if this solution existed, then I must apply boundary condition, and the boundary condition at x is equal to 0 means the wave function should be equal to 0. So, if I put x is equal to 0, I get ax plus bx is equal to 0. So, this is what I am writing, ax plus bx is equal to 0. Now, even at x is equal to l, this should be 0. So, I put ax e raised to power alpha l plus bx e raised to power minus alpha l to be equal to 0. So, this should be equal to 0, rather ax plus bx is equal to 0. So, ax is equal to minus bx. So, I put bx is equal to minus ax. So, this becomes ax e raised to power alpha l is equal to ax e raised to power minus alpha l. Now, if this condition has to be satisfied, then either ax should be 0. If ax is equal to 0, then in that particular case, the wave function has to be 0, because, you know, this is the product, okay, by general solution has to be ax containing a term which is ax multiplied by ay multiplied by az. So, this will give 0. Other possibility is that alpha l is equal to 0, and because l cannot be 0, therefore alpha has to be equal to 0, and if alpha has to be equal to 0, then ax, now because here ax plus bx, x should be, which is ax plus bx, because in this particular case, if alpha is equal to 0, my solution will be ax plus bx. If alpha is 0, then ax plus bx, and I have already said that boundary condition means ax plus bx is equal to 0, it means x is equal to 0. So, if a solution of this type existed, it means if ki square, one of the ki square would have been negative, in that case, once we apply boundary condition, I would have automatically got the wave function to be equal to 0, because if capital X is equal to 0, only possibility of solution is kx is equal to 0, and that is only possible when entire wave function becomes 0 and particle does not exist, because that is not given. So, it is not possible that a solution like this is possible, and therefore, all individually kx square, ky square, kz square should be positive, or kx, ky, kz should be real. So, I think I will stop here, though my time is over, but you know, if there are some questions, we can entertain questions for another 5-10 minutes.
Sir, in case a potential step,
yes,
that you have called free step problem, E less than V naught,
yeah,
we get R is the 0%. Does it not violate the wave nature of light? As we know, there is a reflection and transmission both, yes, whatever may be the interface.
You cannot, first of all, compare this particular thing with light, because light is a different system. This is a particle system.
Sir, I am saying any wave.
Yeah.
If any wave meet to the interface,
yeah,
it will go for the reflection and transmission both.
That's right.
But in this case, there is 100% the reflection and 0% transmission.
That's right.
Does it not violate the wave nature?
No, it does not violate wave nature, because entire light is reflected. I mean, in what way this particular violates? The only thing is that in case of light, as somebody has pointed out, there is also a possibility that light gets absorbed. Well, that is a thing which I am sort of excluding here, because these are particles. Unless there is a process by which these particles can be absorbed and give rise to something else, okay, I am excluding that possibility. So, these particular particles can either get transmitted or can get reflected. Only thing, their number should be conserved. So, I do not see any way by which the wave nature is sort of, all I am trying to say is that you cannot directly compare with the light, okay, because light, as I said, in principle photons could be absorbed. There are so many methods by which photons could be absorbed. While here we are talking of some different type of particles. If at all they could be absorbed, then they have to be treated in a different fashion. SGS Institute of Technology, Indore.
My question is,
yes,
you talk about the particle in a box,
yes,
but the potential is symmetric. What about the asymmetric potential? Sorry, your explanation is for asymmetric potential, the x is equal to 0 to l.
See,
it is for symmetric from minus l by 2 to l by 2.
See, what you are trying to say that in the same particle in a box problem, if I would have made the problem symmetric, are you saying
yes,
that
sir.
Thing?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that poses absolutely no problem. That's what I said. You try to do the exercise yourself. I put, let's say, minus L by 2, put 0 and put L by 2. You write exactly the same equations which you are writing, A sin kx plus B cos kx. All right. Now, you apply the boundary condition at minus L by 2 and plus L by 2. You will find neither A nor B becomes 0. In one of the cases, it will become minus B, another case become plus B. You solve the equations, you will get exactly the same answer of energy. Of course, wave function will become different because this particular term, I mean, you know what is the wave function first. The first wave function will be this, like this. So, this will contain only cos term. The second wave function will be like this. Okay, which using this particular origin will contain a sine term. Nothing of that will change. In fact, this normally to first year students, I give as an exercise in one of the tutorials, say that solve this particular problem by taking minus L by 2 and plus by L by 2 and convince yourself that you will get exactly the same value of energy. In fact, the plots will look exactly identical. But of course, the functional form will look different because my origin has shifted to 0, or my origin has shifted to this particular point rather than this particular point. See, in earlier case, my solutions were all sine. Here, they will be alternately sine and cosine. It makes no difference.
Means in symmetric case, there will always be a cosine term.
No, it will be alternately cosine and sine term. First term will be cosine, second will be sine, then again there will be cosine, then again there will be sine term.
The previous discussion, you said that the ground state energy of hydrogen atom is corresponding to nx is equals to 1 for the calculation of energy states of that deep potential well and infinite potential well.
Yeah.
Yeah, for three dimensional cases,
yeah.
If it is nx is equals to 0, 1 and ny is equals to 0 and nz is equals to 0, then there may be the possibility.
No, no, that's not an allowed state because, if any one of them becomes 0, wave function becomes 0. So, least value is nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 1 and nz is equal to 1.
Okay, nx should start from 1.
It should start
from nx, see, minimum
yes.
value of n.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay.
This is Amrita.
Can you please throw some light on the wave function for the special case of E equals to V0?
Infinite potential well?
Yeah, in the finite potential well,
yeah.
Where one side is finite, the other side is infinite.
Okay.
The first problem.
Okay. I presume you are talking of this particular problem. Is it right?
Yeah, correct.
Okay. See, first of all, a particular bound state has to exist. Let's imagine that one bound state appears, then this particular bound state, because the wave function has to be 0 here, so it will start from here, it will be sinusoidal term, but it cannot terminate 0 here because wave function is not 0 here. Okay? In fact, wave function has to exponentially decay. So, this will have a term, sine term, which goes like this and comes somewhere, and in fact, I am exaggerating here, and then this particular part, it will exponentially decay. Okay? At this particular point, not only the wave function, but its derivative should also be continuous. So, it has to be a smooth curve like this. So, this will be the first, the ground state wave function. If the second wave function, the first excited state wave function also exists, then in that case, remember it has to start from 0 here. So, it will go like this, it will come back like this, and then eventually it has to decay like this. All right. So, this will not cut here in the halfway, but it will be somewhere on the right hand side, because one full quarter wavelength, half wavelength will come and rest will leak out here at this particular point. So, this is the way wave function will look like. And if you just make a mirror reflection, you will say that this particular thing, if I just put another one, these will be the alternate solutions for a particle in a finite box, whether there is no barrier.
Yeah, correct. My question was for the special case of equals to V0, what will happen to the...
E is equal to V0, you just have a solution which is just at this particular point, which is just equal to E is equal to V0. In fact, you could have solved this particular equation, okay, just by putting E is equal to V0, and then you would have got exactly the same equation which I have obtained earlier, okay. The solution is just a straight line.
Just a straight line in the second region as well.
Yeah, that's
right.
Because, see, that is the only one which will satisfy all the conditions, because, you know, you want wave function to be 0 here, you also want it to be continuous.
Oh, thank you.
You can try it out independently yourself, and then, you know, if you have any doubt, you can send the question to me.
1011.
Jaipur Engineering College.
What are the possible origins of zero point energy?
See, origin is quantum mechanics. See, as I say, quantum mechanics is my basic law. Okay, from that particular law, I am getting this particular equation. So I have no other control. So this is the way nature is. See, like when I say why particle, when I apply a force, why a particle does acceleration? Okay, it's because there is a Newton's law of motion. Okay, similarly, why there is a zero point energy? This comes from Schrodinger equation. It's as simple as that. So there is no origin. I mean, quantum mechanics is the origin, because my quantum mechanics is my law. From that particular law, I am getting that zero point energy should exist. This is Motilal Nehru, MNIT. Okay.
Sir, there is a question regarding the tunneling, sir. No. Yes, sir. The process tunneling can be explained in the order of nanotechnology, nanoparticles.
See, there are so many places where the tunneling happens. Now, I am not very sure when you say nanoparticles, also there are many things happening. But there is a possibility of tunneling in some, I mean, it depends on what process are you talking. Okay, so tunneling is whenever they have a potential barrier, okay, which in principle classically is forbidden, but you can find the particles, if this is small enough, you can find significant number of particles crossing that particular thing. So, I am not sure whether specifically for some aspect of nanoparticles whether you can see tunneling, but I will not be surprised if you see tunneling.
You have one more question?
Okay, please.
One more question regarding wave packet.
Yes.
There are infinite number of waves forming wave packet.
That's correct.
Then in every case, there are infinite number of waves, then the size of wave packet will be very large.
No. See, if you have infinite wave, you require infinite waves to limit the length of the size of the packet. If there is only one wave, then wave packet is infinite. When you are mixing many more waves, then only the size is becoming finite. Okay. So, a finite size wave packet consists of an infinite number of infinite waves. Alright, so this is not correct that I am mixing lot of wave packets, so my wave packet will grow. In fact, I have given you example that if I mix two waves, then this particular maximum keeps on going further and further off. If I mix three waves, then it further off. So, if you mix infinite waves, okay, this pushed off forever. So, it gets limited.
Thank you.
This is MS Bidwe.
Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, good afternoon, Latur. Yes.
Yes, sir. Potential, page number 9, if we refer. So here, equal to 0 and x is equal to L, we have considered.
Yes.
But when we consider the potential well, and it is the bisection of the potential well. Yes. So if the center point, we consider x is equal to 0, instead of that, if we consider L by 2, then it would be better, and we can proceed further with that consideration.
Are you saying that this is the way I should consider it?
Yes.
Okay, this is what I told you, that there is absolutely no difficulty in considering this way. In fact, many of the textbooks prefer in this particular way fashion, because this gives you solution which are more symmetrical. Alright, so there is this is a personal preference. I take 0 to L and give this as a problem to the students to work it out. Okay, I could have done the other way, I could have taken minus L by 2 to L by 2. And given them as a problem, other one. See, basically, where I choose origin, my physics is not going to change. Alright? So, it depends on what you find much more convenient. See, the advantage of giving 0 to L is that because that's the first problem I solve on quantum mechanics, and you get one single solution of sign, which is rather simple to start with. Okay? Otherwise, you have to always keep on varying between cosine and sine, and you have to keep on giving argument on that particular thing. So, I mean, for the first level course, I find it convenient to talk of 0 to L and then give this as a problem. But it's a matter of choice, sure, you are right, I could have done the other way.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, please.
One more question, sir.
Please go ahead.
Sir, my question is on the earlier session that you said that the wave velocity do not depend on the wavelength of the light. Then what is the relation V is equal to n lambda?
No. Sorry, I think you misunderstood it. See, relationship V is equal to n lambda when I am trying to say, let me put it like that. If I say relationship is V is equal to n lambda and V is constant, alright, then in that particular case, this is what we call as a non-dispersive medium, alright. In general, this is n, which we call as a frequency, in fact, many times we call nu lambda, alright. This nu depends on omega and lambda depends on k, alright. In general, if you talk of an arbitrary wave, including the particle wave, the relationship between omega and k is fairly complex. So, if you try to calculate velocity using this relationship, this will not be a correct way of looking at it. So, what you do, you actually use this particular expression. See, let me put it like that. What is omega by k? Omega by k is 2 pi nu divided by 2 pi by lambda. So, this is nu lambda. So, which essentially means if omega by k is a function of k wavelength, it means v is also a function of k. So, this relationship will hold good for phase velocity. Remember, phase velocity for that particular value of wavelength, because if I change the wavelength, phase velocity will change. But what is important, that if this happens, then in that case, this velocity is of not physical significance. Then what you should calculate is d omega dk, and calculate d omega by dk at a particular given value of k, because all realistic waves are actually wave packets, and wave packets travel with this speed and not this speed. But on the other hand, if v does not depend on k, then omega by k is constant, then d omega dk has the same value. In that case, group velocity and phase velocities are same. So, whenever I am saying that a wave travels, or rather wave packet travels with the same speed and lambda, where v is constant, okay, group velocity and phase velocity happen to be same. But in general, this need not be. And in that case, I must calculate the speed of wave packet, and speed of wave packet is calculated by using relationship d omega dk and not omega by k. And of course, d omega dk also in general will be a function of k. I am not sure whether I have explained you or your question is answered or not.
Okay, okay. There is my another question that.
Yeah, please go ahead.
In double slit experiment.
Yeah, yeah.
The phenomenon of interference is due to the waves only.
Yes.
But if we replace the wave by photon or the electron, yes, how is it possible?
I mean, that's what I'm trying to say. That, you know, there are certain phenomena which can be better understood only on the wave basis. If you want to insist on explaining these phenomena on particle basis, you have issues, and then you have to give rise of the idea of what we call as uncertainty. Then there are certain things which I cannot understand. This is precisely what I am trying to say, that there are certain phenomena which are better understood only by the wave nature. If you insist that I want to talk only of also of the particle nature, then I have issues. Then I will not be able to understand how these particles reach there. That's precisely what I am trying to say. See, wave-particle duality brings certain amount of complications in the way I look, because according to me, the classical particle is a particle which is localized. Okay. On the other hand, so long I consider this as a wave, I have no issue. Similarly, in photoelectric effect experiment, if I have to explain this on the basis of wave nature, I have a lot of issues. But on the basis of particle, I can explain it very well. All right, this is precisely what is the idea.
Will the particle nature will also show the same interference pattern or not?
If you are seeing interference pattern, that can be better explained on the basis of wave nature. Okay, even though you may like to call this particle as a classical particle, like electron or a neutron. All right. Okay, I think we'll just close this session.